Welcome to Dospeth Grace Assembly. Our assembly today is about values. Yesterday was World Values Day. We were thinking about the values which are the most important to our class. I gave out a set of values, basic values, or values that perhaps might be appropriate to lots of people. So I wanted you to decide in your group, in your class group, what would be shared, three top shared values in your group. Cut it out, stick it on a leaf, and then go and stick it on the values tree in the foyer. What are values? Values are things that are really important to us. They underpin what we think and how we act. They might vary from person to person, but as I said, there are basic values which I think a lot of people will share. So it would be great to see how the tree looks and if there are any shared values in Digwyn School. Okay, we're going to move on now to something I'd like to share with you. It's about a value which is very important at the moment. It's about caring for the environment, and it's a project called Dirt is Good, a great project run by Purcell and Future Foundations and Global Development. So it's all moving towards taking care of our environment and taking action. It's getting young people to take action on the environment. Caring for the environment is a value we're focusing on now, and I'd like to share this PowerPoint with you based on a project called Dirt is Good, run by Purcell in conjunction with Film Foundations and a Global Action Plan in order to influence and inspire young children in schools in order to take action in their environment, in their local community, either in school or in their local community. We had an initial meeting with some children from Digwyn, and it was decided that we would focus, being united in compassion, we decided it would be good to focus on developing and doing up the pond area, the pond and pond area. This is to help the children care for the environment, to help them become change makers. It is about a process, it's about working, everybody mucking in, getting involved and just having a go. It's about the process of changing an area. So we needed inspiration. We looked at some photographs of different ponds to see maybe what we would like. We thought about the sort of wildlife we'd like to attract, frogs and toads and newts. Frog spawn, be great to have frog spawn and see the baby froglets and just observe them. Also insects, it would be great to attract insects to this new environment. Insects would be good to have insects in the pond area because they create a good ecosystem, a healthy ecosystem, so that it would encourage more frogs or wildlife to come to the pond. We also decided that pond plants would be essential to make the water healthy, to get oxygen in the water and to make it look nice so that the wildlife has something to eat. Also lilies, we thought, you know, perhaps a lily might look nice, be good for frogs to sit on or hide under, and other insects to hide under. We looked at different tubs that we could have in the pond area. We also thought about recycling, using old recycled pallets to make the plant tubs. So I've got a couple of people who might be able to help us with that. And obviously, you know, as many children who would like to get involved, that would be great. So we also thought it would be good to have a fountain. It would be good because the water would agitate the surface of the fountain would agitate the surface of the water, and create a healthy environment. Also be good to listen to and create a nice calm area. We also thought it would be fun to have some lights there if possible. Well, why? Why are we doing this? We're doing this to inspire pupils to care and act to help our environment, a very important issue now and will be ongoing for a long time. As part of our value on protecting and helping the environment, I'd like to share this story with you. It's called The Messy Magpie. Enjoy.
The Messy Magpie. It's often been noted, as years have gone by, that magpies collect all the things that they spy. They love all things colourful, shiny and bold, no matter how tiny, no matter how old. Morris the magpie is the same, it would seem, as he loves to pick up any objects that gleam. He takes them all home to his nest in a tree to make it look special for others to see. Now one day, young Morris was struck by surprise when a gift was thrown down right in front of his eyes. As it flew from a car, Morris said, "Could it be that this human has given a present to me?" He swooped down to pick up the beautiful gift, which was hard to manoeuvre and heavy to lift. He carried it home, though it took him all day, then he cleaned up his present to put on display. He wanted to decorate all that he could, so the next day he went to the edge of the wood. He flew to the place where the gift had been dropped, where he saw that a family of humans had stopped. He hopped down to search for his gift on the floor, but he noticed that this time they'd left many more. Shimmering treasures amongst all the green, these gifts were the finest that Morris had seen. Each day he returned and he couldn't believe all the wonderful gifts that were left to retrieve. His tree was soon bursting with no space for more, so he started to spread them all out on the floor. The more of these gifts that his human friends threw, the more his collection expanded and grew. Then one day, as Morris was sat in his tree, admiring the beauty of all he could see, he noticed that things were now changing below, that the plants were all dying and struggling to grow. The grass was not green like it had been before. The flowers were wilting, not bright anymore. His animal friends watched in fear and distress as their homes and their food were soon lost to the mess. He turned to the stream, which no longer looked blue, but instead had a horrible, muddy-like hue. The water was flowing more slowly that day, as the big piles of rubbish were blocking its way. "Oh no," Morris cried, as he gasped with alarm. "I never intended to cause all this harm. The forest is damaged. The humans weren't kind. All these gifts were just rubbish that got left behind." The pride Morris felt for his lovely display was soon turning to sadness, regret, and dismay. He adored the collection he'd lovingly built, but his joy had now turned to a feeling of guilt. He vowed to himself he would put it all right, so he leapt off his branch and then quickly took flight. He soared high and low, looking out for a clue that would show him the safest and best thing to do. He noticed a truck driving past on the road, which was filled with a very familiar load. He followed the truck to see where it would go, feeling hopeful he'd find what he needed to know. Morris arrived at a bustling place, which had giant containers and masses of space. Each bin had a sign marking what it was for, and the rubbish piled up, with each car adding more. "Where does it go?" whispered Morris, confused. To his shock, a voice said, "It gets crushed and reused." A seagull appeared and then said with a sigh, "It's amazing what humans can do when they try. "That's it," Morris said, and he knew what to do. "If I bring it all here, they can make something new. I might need some help, but I must make amends." So he called on a couple of very good friends. They fetched and they carried for most of the night, and they worked as a team till they'd put it all right. When the rubbish was gone, Morris looked all around, at the stream and the flowers, the trees and the ground. He desperately hoped that he'd made enough room for the beauty of nature to once again bloom. He planted and watered and nurtured away till the forest was thriving and growing each day. Then Morris knew nothing would make his heart sing like the colourful beauty that nature could bring. He no longer needed the shiniest nest, and he realised that having a green home was best.
Now we're going to listen to a song by the children from the Broadway School, who are very keen to become eco warriors. There's lots of advice in this song. You may also like to join in and do some marching with them.
Thank you. Everybody knows what's like to be a dog, except a dog. Here we go. Nobody knows what it's like to be a dog, except a dog. Here we go. Nobody knows what it's like to be a sheep, except a sheep. Nobody knows what it's like to be a sheep, except a sheep. Nobody knows what it's like to be a cat, except a cat. Nobody knows what it's like to be a cat, except a cat. Okay, we're gonna do a slightly bigger cat now. Nobody knows what it's like to be a lion, except a lion. Nobody knows what it's like to be a lion, except a lion. Nobody knows what it's like to be a cow, except a cow. Nobody knows what it's like to be a cow, except a cow. Here we go. Nobody knows what it's like to be a bird, except a bird. Nobody knows what it's like to be a bird, except a bird. Nobody knows what it's like to be a pig, except a pig. Nobody knows what it's like to be a pig, except a pig. Nobody knows what it's like to be a duck, except a duck. Nobody knows what it's like to be a duck, except a duck. Tunnel. tunnel came the train again. They raced all day and they never looked back. And that's how they, and that's how they, and that's how they carried on.
Just kneel and say, thank you, Lord, for my work and play. I try to be good, for I know that I should. That's my prayer at the end of the day. All together at the end of the day, just kneel and say, thank you, Lord, for my work and play. I try to be good, for I know that I should. That's my prayer at the end of the day.